السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعين به ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله، بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في سبيل الله حق جهاده حتى أتاه اليقين، ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين. أما بعد، my dear respect brothers and sisters, today we're going to be talking about the methods and the instruments within the fiqh al-da'wah. Just to kind of review very quickly of some of the things that we talked about last week, we said that in order for you to conduct da'wah, you have to at least know the basics of al-fiqh that it requires, or the da'wah. And we said that the fiqh of the da'wah, or to know the rulings of giving the da'wah, it requires three pillars. We said that the very first pillar within fiqh al-da'wah is we have to know what the da'iyah is calling for, okay? And we talked about he have to be, you know, what is he calling to? And the third pillar is who is the caller is calling, the person who is calling. So al-da'i, al-da'i lah, wal-mad'u. And we said that this is the three pillars for fiqh al-da'wah. And each one of them we talked about, there have to be some sort of details that are required for each one of them. Today, some of the scholars, they said, well, in order for you to complete this, you have to have methods and instruments that are required for you to know how to conduct da'wah. So the very first thing, and this is, the methods are required. The methods are required. So the question is that we're going to be asking ourselves now, what is the method? What is a method? A method is a way or an art that is effective to be carried to the people. So whatever way, whatever art that we need to deliver this message to the people is considered to be a method. Now, in order to kind of put this into, imagine this, we have, imagine as you are knowing the map, and you have several highways that you have to go through. In order for you to know to go from point A to point B, you have to know all the ways that are required. And this is the methods. Sometimes it takes a simple straight line. Sometimes you have to go and curve around. Sometimes you have to go above everybody. So there have to be there's a lot of ways for you to go from point A to point B. The scholars, what they said, one of the most important methods for you to conduct da'wah, they said, is diagnosis and treatment. And when two people say diagnosis and treatment, what is the very first thing they think about? As you are being a doctor. And this is the exact way that we should be thinking when we are trying to give nasiha, or we're trying to rectify somebody from doing something wrong, or we want to do da'wah. What does that mean? Like, for instance, when you are trying to deliver, or you wanted to advise someone about something, you actually have to make sure before you advise him, you have to diagnose him, just like a doctor would. For instance, if you go to a doctor, what's the very first thing the doctor is going to do before he gives you the medication, before he examines you, and etc.? He does what you call past medical history, history plus an illness, and he has to take all of your history before he'd be able to kind of know who you are. The same thing when you are giving advice to someone, you have to know, beyond knowing what religious background this person is from, you have to know how severe is the problem. You have to know his personality. Is he harsh? Is he soft? You have to know how he conducts himself. Is he easygoing? Is he difficult? Is he serious about you giving him advice? Or is he disregarding you? You have to know his personality. Before you have even to think about giving him an advice. Just like the doctor would give medicine, the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a medicine to the heart. So therefore, we have to know how we are delivering this message to the people. And beyond that, my dear respect brothers, people have different problems. Yeah, for instance, if I'm going to rectify somebody who is committing some sort of association between him and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is it the same way I'm going to treat him just like somebody who's committing a ma'asiyah? or a huge sin or a small sin. These are different levels. We can't, I mean, people now, when they want to advise someone or they want to correct someone, they have one way highway. There is no way, there's no other ways. There's many other ways in which you have to know how to deliver this message to the people. And sometimes the dose is different. The tone of your voice, how are you gonna make him get this message? It's gonna differ based on how severe is the problem. So this is number one. You have to know your person, you have to diagnose him before you treat him or give him the advice. The second problem, and I see many, many people disregarded, is in which the scholars, they would call it the removal of the shubuhat before we reach the goal. The removal of the shubuhat before we reach the goal. So many people, when we give da'wah to the non-Muslims, they say, I believe everything you say. But what, and then you ask him, what's stopping you from becoming a Muslim? He said, wallahi, I don't believe this, and I don't believe that, I don't believe this. So there are some barriers between him and Islam. So you have to address these barriers. And sometimes the same thing when it comes to the Muslims. Sometimes, for instance, you see people, when they have, like, for instance, the iman would decrease, and they would reach the point that they have doubts about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For instance, they'll say, how come, you stop coming to the masjid, or you're about to leave the religion? He would tell you, wallahi, I've seen this. In which they would say, I don't believe in a creator. He's a Muslim. It's not making sense to me. And then you would ask him, what are the barriers? What prevented you from doing? And then you take it one by one. For instance, they would say, how could someone, the shaitan would come to me and tell me, who created the earth? You would say, Allah. And then who created the skies? They would say, Allah. Then the shaitan would come to him, then who created Allah? And the shaitan would take him step by step to the point that now he is half doubting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then after that, he would question himself, why I'm doing this from the beginning? Then we would teach him and we would tell him that, for instance, each and every creation should have a creator. We would teach him that this world would not make any sense if there was no creator. We would ask him, would it even make sense for something for us to exist without a creator? So we would also tell him the fact that each and everything is designed and is fine-tuned. There's no, all this, the universe is fine-tuned and everything have laws. And for you to have laws, there have to be a lawmaker. So people have different doubts. Some people would say, some sisters would say, they would think, for instance, and they got used to knowing that the hijab is only the cover of the head. So what is the barrier here? It's knowledge. They're ignorant. They don't know. The only perception that they have of the hijab is just the covering of the head. So what is the barrier here? Is that you remove that barrier by educating them. Some people have even doubts about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They would say, how you want me to follow the sunnah? How can I follow the sunnah? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam married a 9-year-old Aisha. Then you would tell him, this is something that have happened 1400 years ago. And many, many people have done the same thing at the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the east and in the west. And the enemies of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam have not criticized him. And who are we 1400 years after that? We would criticize him for that. Some people will say, how can Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam have many hadith that talks about killing the innocent people? We would tell him, no, this is something wrong with your understanding. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam never ordered somebody to kill innocent people. All of the hadith and many of the verses of the Quran talks about killing or waging war in the context of a war. Nothing beyond and nothing less than that. And we teach them how Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us that the life of the human beings is cherishable, it's have value, and etc. So a lot of people have doubts. And for them, you cannot give them this da'wah unless you clear these doubts from them one by one. And these doubts can be ignorance. Sometimes these doubts can be shubuhat. And inshallah, part of this course is that we were going to be talking about these shubuhat one after another, so people will be able to kind of know how to answer them in the future. So this is, so the very first problem, the very first message that we have to know is, one, we have to know how to diagnose the person in front of us. Second is we have to know how to clear the shubuhat that are standing between the person and him reaching the message. Number three is, people sometimes is, we have to utilize the method of at-targhib wa at-tarhib, is how to get people closer to us and seduce them to come to Islam, and how to warn them otherwise. Like, for instance, again, going back to the example of a doctor. The doctor have to show the benefit of the medicine and have to show, you have to warn the patient what would happen if he does not take the medicine. And in the past, we talked about that at-targhib wa at-tarhib, warning people and trying to show them Islam in a very beautiful way, varies from one person to another. Like, for instance, we said that at-targhib, meaning that you show them, you try to be soft with them and gentle with them, works when somebody is new to Islam, when somebody is ignorant, and when somebody is far away from you. What do I mean by that? So these are three things we have to keep in our mind. Like, for instance, I have to be gentle with the people who are not close to me. I don't know them, right? I can't be harsh to them. I have to be soft and gentle with the people who are new. They don't know anything. I have to be soft and gentle with people who are ignorant. Vice versa, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, sometimes he used to use harsh tones in people who are close to him. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, we talked about this in the past, the example of the Arab urinating in the mosque of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam versus Abu Bakr Siddiq or Umar Khattab radiallahu anhu committing a mistake. You see? So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, how he dealt with people who are knowledgeable, people who are old, meaning in Islam, and people who are close to him, sometimes he utilized the methods of being serious with them, to show them this is something that is serious. So the meaning that we have to know how to utilize some of the methods, we have to know how to be, when to be gentle and when to be serious with the people. The fourth methods that we should, that a lot of people tend to forget is, when I invite somebody or I guided someone to Islam, or so I advise someone and he listened to me, I have to make sure I'm following him afterward. For instance, somebody is not praying, and I told them the hadith of the importance of the prayer, the punishment of not praying, you know, the benefits of praying, and what the very first thing that a person would be asked about in his grave when he's praying. Then now, alhamdulillah, he started to pray. Does that mean I stop here and I leave him? No, it doesn't work. I have to make sure that from time to time I talk to him. I have to make sure he's coming to the masjid. I keep close connection with him. Just like, again, the example of a doctor. So, you know, when a doctor treating his patients, you have two types of patients. Someone you have to be in the hospital, you have to see him each and every day, and someone you could treat him as an outpatient, meaning he could come once every 6 months or once every year, right? But the person who is very sick, you have to keep him in the hospital so you can see him every day and make sure you treat him every day and give him higher doses of medication. The same thing when it comes to somebody who is waking iman. You have to make sure that you are following with him day after day until his iman becomes stronger, and then after that you let him go, and then inshallah you'll be able to find someone else that you could be able to guide and show him, you know, Islam. So following people is very important when it comes to one of the methods in conducting our da'wah. Obviously, and we have talked about this in the past, each and every way we are doing it, no matter what, whatever method that we are realizing, we have to be within the realm of wisdom. We have to be, you know, we have to make sure that we are, for instance, being gentle with the people. We have to make sure that we are smiling in the faces of the people, and we have to make sure that we are effective in that we are delivering our da'wah. So this is as far as some of the methods. So again, what we mean here by methods is the highways that we take to get from point A to point B. Now in this highway, there have to be some sort of vehicles or some sort of instruments. So what are an instrument? An instrument, any vehicle or something that you use to get you into to go through these methods. But again, the scholars have divided these instruments or these vehicles that we utilize when we are conducting our da'wah into something that is external and something that is internal. What are some of the external and internal instruments that we need in order to conduct our da'wah? Very first thing is, and a lot of people don't think about these things, is safety. Safety. What do I mean by that? Before you say any word, and when you are delivering the da'wah, you have to make sure that you are safe and your da'wah is safe. What do I mean by that? And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam have done that throughout his Meccan period, in which that he made sure that whatever he says, he is safe, and his companions are safe, and his da'wah is safe. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, all of us know that when in the initial phase of his da'wah, he was in Darul Arqam. Why? Because he does not want his people to get rid of him and his people. Why? He thought about his safety. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he traveled from Mecca to the Medina, how he did it? He did it in a secret. Why? Because of his safety. When Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked the people to go and make hijrah to Al-Habasha, he told them to do it in secret. Why? Because their safety. When Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam became out open about his da'wah, when he had somebody who could back him up, like Umar Khattab radiallahu anhu and Hamza. So meaning that before he went up, you know, and he took very courageous levels, he made sure somebody is backing him up before he go forward. And not only that, we're talking about the morals, the safety, you know, as far as our physical safety, even moral safety. We have to make sure that we are safe from committing sins, and we are safe from not compromising our religion to satisfy others. So this is extremely, and the thing is, for any time somebody does any da'wah, who is the very first two types of people who would hate you? The mudafiqeen, the hypocrites, and the kuffar. And this is the same thing that happened to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam started his da'wah in Mecca, who were the people who were against him? The kuffar of Quraysh. When he was in Medina, who was his enemies? Was the hypocrites. Always tried to, you know, put down everything that he is doing. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, many times from the beginning of the Quran all the way to the end, how many times he have warned us of the hypocrites and their character and how they conduct themselves, so we don't be like them. So therefore, an important instrument that we have to think about when we are saying anything, we have to make sure that we are safe. And we have to make sure that the community is safe. Like, for instance, I'm not going to say something dangerous that is going to make people hate us and enrage people against us, so people would harm the Muslim community. Of course not. It's stupid, and it's going to be. And why would I? Because I wanted to guide one person, I would harm most of my community. It wouldn't make any sense. You see what I'm saying? So we have the very most important things is safety as an important instrument in how we are conducting ourselves when we're making da'wah. And as Prophet Muhammad as Umar Khattab radiallahu anhu said, Al-Muslimu kayyisun fatan, that the Muslim is smart and he's awake. You know, he's not doing things out in the open, just, you know, and random. No, a Muslim, he's always awake and he's always aware and cautious of his situation. The second thing is, it is important, my dear brothers, is when we are conducting da'wah, is that we don't just do it. I mean, you could do it by yourself as an individual, but it's always better when you seek the help of others. When you seek the help of others. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلْتَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ أُمَّةٌ يَدْعُونَ إِلَى الْخَيْرِ, meaning a group. And this group, so the next important thing is, beyond safety, is you have to seek the help of others. And once you seek the help of others, what is the third step is you become organized. And this is extremely important, because thing is, any da'wah organization or any da'wah effort have to be organized. Wallahi alayhim, but my dear brothers, we overlook some of the things that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam have done when he did simple things that we read about in his sunnah. For instance, when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam traveled from Mecca to Medina secretly, you know what he did? The scholar said, first of all, he found his who's gonna go out with. He planned. He's very organized. He found who was gonna go out with. He planned the time. He planned who's gonna show him the way. He planned the way that he's going to take. He planned the time. He's planned who's gonna give him the food while he was hiding. He literally had an actual plan from point A to point Z. It was not just random, just pick up and go and let me go. He planned who's gonna sleep in his bed. Ali radiallahu anhu. So he had a whole lot of plan before he went from point A to point B. When Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did or made Ghazwat al-Khandaq, you know, the battle of the trench, what happened? He literally, some of the scholars, they say, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he had people who were responsible for digging. Other group who responsible for carrying the sand. Other people who responsible for guarding the place. Other people who were responsible for making sure everybody. It was a plan. So meaning that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was not just random. No, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was. If it comes to organization, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was an example of how things was organized. So these things we have to keep in mind. It's not just random and tawakkal ala Allah. Well, tawakkal ala Allah with organization. You see what I'm saying? So this is as far as external factors. When we're conducting our dawah, we have to make sure that we are safe. We have to make sure that we are seeking the help of others, and we have to be organized. Now, when it comes to internal, like what are some of the internal instruments that we have to use? I'm going to end with this, inshallah, that we need to use when we are conducting dawah. The scholars, they say they have a hadith that they go off by. And all of us know this hadith. من رأى منكم منكرًا فيغيره بيده فإن لم يستطع فبلسانه فإن لم يستطع فبقلبه ذلك ضعف الإيمان. Whoever sees something wrong, he changes with his hand. If he can, he changes with his mouth. If he can't, then with his heart. And that's the lowest of iman. Now, no one can change things with his hand. No one can change things with your son, unless you have authority. Like, for instance, you have authority over your son, over your daughter. But somebody from the outside, you have no authority over. No one have authority unless you're like part of the government. But so the issue of using the hand, it comes with people who have authority, if you have a government and etc. Now, we have our speech. So what some of the things that we could use when we are delivering the da'wah? So the very first thing, التبليغ بالقول, that we give da'wah with our tongue. What does this mean? A lot of people think when we give da'wah with our voice, with our tongue, meaning, you know, some of the examples that people say, giving khutbah, giving lessons, giving muhadarat, giving halaqat, and etc. But, you know, this does not apply to each and every person, right? Again, that does not end it. Who said a khatib, only the person who gives the khutbah should be giving da'wah? No. When you are among with your family, with your daughters and sons, when you are with your friends, when you're going out, when you are just sitting outside of the masjid, anytime you have a group of people that you could give da'wah to, that's considered to be a tabligh bil qawl, that you are giving da'wah with your speech. Now, we talked about this last time, the example of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, when somebody told him, "Ya Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, please give us talk each and every day." He said, "I do as Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam have done, in which that I give a lesson once in a while." So people is not going to be overwhelmed. Same thing, when you are trying to deliver a da'wah, a tabligh bil qawl, that you don't try each and every thing that you see you criticize, or each and every gathering you see you try to give da'wah. It's good, but the thing is, people, When I see you giving me advice here, and then when I go outside, you give me advice in front of the masjid, and when I go outside, you give me a third advice, people would naturally will avoid you. It's human nature. And when you always try to criticize people, people think, you know what, even if everything that you say is correct, but people, not everybody change that quickly. So therefore, you have to be gentle, and you have to be wise in your speech as far as when to give the advice, and when people are perceptive for your talk. So, like I said, at tabligh bil qawl, it can be not necessarily with our speech. It's now Subhanallah, we live in the 21st century in which there is many ways in which we could da'wah with, whether it was through media, through Facebook, through Twitter, through WhatsApp, through sharing a fatwa with the people, giving them a pamphlet, giving them a book. There is a lot of ways in which that if you want to really guide someone, there is a lot, many, many ways. And it can be direct and it can be indirect. But the point is, do you have that feeling of rectifying the people? That's important. Because people, many people, they would say, لَكُمْ دِينُكُمْ وَلِيَدِينَ. You know, you do whatever I want, you want, and I do whatever I want. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا عَلَيْكُمْ أَنفُسَكُمْ لَا يَضُرُّكُمْ مَنْ ضَلَّ. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ عَلَيْكُمْ أَنفُسَكُمْ. Oh, who you believe? Just take care of yourself. You know, and they mention this verse. Yeah, people have to understand what is this verse, and people have to understand that it's an obligation on us to give da'wah and change when the incorrect things that we see around us. So therefore, my dear respected brothers, it's important that we not keep this knowledge, or when we see something wrong, that we just take care of ourselves. We love our brothers, we love our sisters, and we want to make sure that all of us, all of this community is a healthy community in which all of us abide the sunnah by what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us and the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So anyway, when we are talking and giving the da'wah with our talk, make sure the few things that you have to keep in mind. You have to be effective in your speech. What does that mean? Meaning that you give words that are compelling to the people, that you are trying to make them believe you. Not just make sure that you organize your words. Second is, you have to make sure you give things that are pertinent to the people. Why would you give me a da'wah about something I don't even care about? You see, you try to make sure, you have to show me this is important, and you have to encourage me this is important before you try to show me whether this is halal or haram. You have to talk to me in a way that I understand. If somebody down the street, an elderly person who is illiterate, you have to make sure you use very simple words. When somebody comes to him and says, this is bid'ah, and he doesn't even know what is bid'ah, and what is saghira, and what is kabira, and you're stabbing him with all these terminologies, how was he going to even understand? So you have to know, you have to use that language that this person can understand. People have to comprehend you. And the last important thing, and this is something I see so much these days, is you can be demeaning to the people. I am the sheikh and you are the asi. You are the sinner. It doesn't work that way. You have to be humble. You are a student or a messenger that giving the people knowledge. You can't be demeaning to the people. Oh, look at you. How come you are doing this? Haram alayka, and putting him down. No, it doesn't work that way. You have to humble yourself. You have to say it in a way that people will take it from you. Otherwise, people will reject you and you reject your advice. Second thing is, when we are giving da'wah, at-tabligh bil-amal, meaning that we are giving da'wah with action. We clean around the masjid. We clean around the neighborhood. We give people food. We show people what Islam is with action and not saying a single word. At-tabligh bil-amal. And this is something simple. Any masjid or any da'wah organization can simply organize that, in which that we show the people, instead of us talking about ourselves, we show the people what Islam is all about. And lastly, my dear respected brothers, is, and this is a notice, we want from al-qawl, that we are from speech, and action to the indirect da'wah. So a lot of people now, when you tell them, how can I give da'wah? They say, well, you give da'wah, silent da'wah, in which that you show people morality. And this is good, but this is like the last step in the ladder of the priorities. Now people jump into the last step. No, there are many ways, there are more important ways in order for you how to conduct yourself and how you should be delivering the da'wah. Yes, we're not avoiding the fact that somebody could get da'wah with his morality. But in the same token, that's the lowest level. This is when you can't do any other things. You can't do da'wah with action, and you can't do da'wah with your speech. You see? A lot of people now jump into that and leave the other. But even with that, when you want to give da'wah with morality, you have to be up to that level in which that you are, what do I mean? That you are have the good morals. You are not a liar. You're humble. You are soft. You are gentle. You lower your gaze. You follow the sunnah, and etc. So So meaning that not just having the morality, but also applying the morality. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, lima taquluna ma la taf'alun. Oh, you who believe, why do you say things that you don't apply to yourself? Meaning that when you say, I'm going to give da'wah with my own action, you have to make sure that you are implementing these actions. Otherwise, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have told the people of Bani Israel, أَتَأْمُرُونَ النَّاسَ بِالْبِرِّ وَتَنْسَوْنَ أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَنْتُمْ تَتْلُونَ الْكِتَابِ أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ. Do you tell the people to do something that is good and you have forgotten about yourselves? So meaning, yes, it's good to do da'wah with your action or with your morality to show the people, you know, what we call the quiet da'wah. But also, it's important that you beautify yourself with this morality, and people, you don't see a gap between your mouth and your action. I tell people to do. I tell people not to lie, and I am the very first liar. I tell people not to backbite, and I backbite everyone. I tell people not to curse, and I am the very person that curses. I tell people to come to the masjid, and I am the. I don't even come to the masjid, and etc. So, meaning these are some of the methods that we talked about. So the thing is, just to kind of summarize everything, we talked about two things today, alhamdulillah rabbil alameen, some of the methods and some of the instruments. And imagine this, when we are going down a highway and we are trying to get from point A to point B, I have to use a route, the right route, and I have to use the right vehicle. And the methods are the route, and the vehicles are the instruments, okay? We said that what are some of the instruments that you could use. We said the very first important thing is that you have to be safe. You have to make sure that you are safe. You have to make sure that you are not doing things by yourself. You have to make sure that you're doing things that are organized. This is as far as instruments. And we said also that some of the external instruments, some of the internal instruments, is that you have to make sure that you are. Making a da'wah with your speech, you're making a da'wah with your action, and they're giving da'wah with indirect da'wah with your morality, and making sure that you do what you're asking people to do. So this is, in brief, some of the methods and the instruments of conducting da'wah. If I said anything that is right, it's indeed from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His Prophet. If I said anything that is improper for myself and the shaitan, جزاكم الله خير لحسن استماعكم سبحانك وحمدك نستغفرك ونتوب اليك والعصر ان الانسان لفي خسر الى الذين امنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر جزاكم الله خير. Is there any questions that people have before we end this? There, inshallah. جزاكم الله خير. جزاك الله.